having some aging issues. So, but we promise we'll come here more, right? Because we know that this is the area that we hope to grow our market reach up, right? Of course, to introduce the right licensing to consumers as well. So I'm going to touch a little bit on Windows 10. I'm sure because Windows 10 has been launched for the past 2 years. So I'm sure you have seen most of the features. Right? But what I'm trying to share here is that when there's a consumer approaching you, right, your retail stores, what are the key things that you should actually mention to them, and why should they get a genuine Windows 10 for the new PC that they are purchasing? So I'll actually focus on some of these areas. So I used to work in the Windows engineering team for Microsoft. So back then, it works very differently, right? So for now, when you look at Windows 10 itself, right, it's actually happening in a two ways scenario. So it's not about what Microsoft wants the end consumers to have for Windows 10, but it's more about what are the feedbacks that we have collected, right, based on surveys and studies that we have done with tremendous amounts of end users. And we actually collected this feedback and we give it on a monthly cadence basis back to our engineering team. So they actually fine-tune and adjust the Windows OS based on all this data that we have collected right from the market. So, and you know that Windows has been around for the past many years. So I don't expect to see something like a huge major improvement in terms of features, like something very special that we haven't seen in the past, because we are somehow there, right? But what we're hoping to see is that fine-tuning the user experience. Okay, so when users using the device, although we have so many different devices in the market, some comes with ink, with pen, some comes with Windows Hello, we just want to make sure that the whole experience is actually is good, right, for all the consumers. So when the customers walk into your retail store and they might ask you the question, why should I get Windows 10, right? Some of them, they were still thinking, maybe I should get Windows 8 or Windows 7 because of compatibility issues, so on and so forth. So let me share with you that Windows 10 and Windows 7 and even Windows 8 are actually running based on the same engine, right? So there shouldn't be a huge compatibility issues for consumer, right? I understand for commercial market, because they have some of the in-house applications which might not be able to run on the current latest version, but that is a separate story. But in consumer space, we should always encourage them to go for Windows 10. And why is that? Windows is no longer a platform, right? We used to call Windows as a platform for different type of devices. But now Windows itself is actually a service. So some of you might be wondering, Microsoft introduced a Windows 11 or Windows 12 or Windows 13. So Windows 10 will be the last version that we're going to ever introduce, right? So to your customers, tell them that this is only one version of Windows we're going to ever introduce in the future. So what we're going to do is that we introduce services as a for Windows, right, as a platform for our customers. So once they purchase this device with a genuine Windows 10, which means that as long as this device is working, all the services and anniversary updates, creator updates will be pumped into the device, and you get to enjoy all these new features. Okay? So it's not like in the past when you got a Windows 7 device, right? Then 1 year down the road, we launch a Windows 8, then you say, oh, we can't get updated to Windows 8 because of a different version. So now the whole scenario has changed. Okay, so remember Windows 10 as a service. Okay, so whenever we normally will release sort of like an update annually, like a big update with some of the new features, the stronger features based on annually. So those are things that will pump in directly into your devices through Windows Update, and you get to choose whether you want to update it or not. Okay? So some of the features here we have seen, but I just want to bring up what we have in Creators Update. So there's the latest version of Windows Update called Creators Update. So a few things that I would like to mention is, if you look at the security, especially for end users, right? Some devices today already come with what we call Windows Hello. So it comes in two different type of device. One, it actually runs on a 3D RealSense camera, which actually sends your facial, right? Then it will actually help to auto-log on, right? Instead of typing your password. So the other type, which is something that I prefer the more, right? I use it on my phone, I use it on my PC as well. So it does read your fingerprint. So once you just just touch your fingerprint, and Windows Hello will kick in, and then it will be able to identify who you are, and it will allow you to log on seamlessly, right, instead of typing password. Okay, So for productivity, I'll go into each of these. So I'll just quickly mention about it. So Windows inking is something that we are hoping to see it grows more in the market. So a couple of things why we expect it to grow bigger, right, or become more common in consumer space is because Microsoft actually acquired several digitizer company, right, such as Entrick. Okay. So what would you expect in future is that the devices that comes with inking, which means that it supports pen, right, will be standardized on the same digitizer, which means today the pen that I use on Surface will be able to use it on other laptops, right? For example, if you bought it from Lenovo, Dell, HP, or Acer. Okay, because most of it, you are enabling the ecosystem to actually run on the same digitizers. So the pen will be something that as an additional accessories, right, for you to sell to your consumers. So you might see more Wacom pen, for example, coming out into the market, which people, it will be like something very stylish, right? People can just hold the pen and actually write it on across different devices. 3D in Windows, there's something really big in Windows Creator Updates version. So we have enhanced the engine. We even have some first party applications that come together with Windows 10 Creators Update, where consumers can actually start using a 3D printer, for example, right, to create some of the 3D objects. Cortana, the service will be available in Malaysia. It runs right on the device, but then the localized services is not enabled in Malaysia yet, but we're hoping that in the near future we'll be able to see Cortana, the local services being enhanced, being enabled locally in Malaysia. So imagine if you have Cortana enabled locally, basically you can just say, Cortana, book me a Uber, right? So not long after that, you'll see a Uber coming to your storefront and you know, to pick you up. So things like that, right? We know Microsoft Edge, right? Our new browser, right, runs faster and it supports inking and it's safer as well. The other thing is the Office and Windows. So as you know that Microsoft, actually it's not just Microsoft, I mean most of the M&C or even platform companies, they're actually moving into the cloud. So that's why these days we are actually enforcing or we're actually promoting Office 365. I'll go into detail why consumers should actually go for that. Gaming is another big thing. So today together with SingleTap, I think this is the right topic for us to discuss about. So for creators updates, we actually enhance the engine with DirectX 12. And not only that, you are actually able to tweak some of the resources to make sure that it's actually reserved for better gaming performance. All right, some of the devices now, even in the factory, when we build the image, we actually custom the configuration itself to make sure that when the end users launch a game, make sure that all the resources are actually reserved for the game application itself, so we get a maximum gaming experience. So if you can think it, you should ink it. So myself, I've got three boys, right? My son, they started to learn about writing, so on and so forth. In fact, I have a Lenovo with pen. So when they play around with it, surprisingly, it attracts a lot of attention from young boys when they start to learn writing, you know, things like that, and even drawing. So that helps. In a lot of scenarios, buying decisions are actually made by the parents, but you have to think about, you know, who actually strike that kind of urge for the parents to buy the device. So mostly actually influence, or even I would call it like an emotional decision to purchase a device. So some of these will actually help to influence the parents. Okay, if you can paint the scenario directly to the parents. Don't worry about all this wording. Like the reason why I have all these slides is that we're going to share the slide with all of you. Okay, so you can actually read it through. So I've mentioned most of the functions here with Windows Ink and also the usability. So Ink, we have all these first party apps that comes built in Windows. So all of these are enhanced to support Ink, right, with a pen. So for example, our sticky notes, our sketchpad, even some of the applications where it does support rulers, for example, like a digital ruler that you can actually write a straight line on the screen. So and not only on the first party application, third party apps like Adobe, they do support this as well. So they actually built in some of our inking functionality into the Adobe applications as well. Okay. So Windows Ink plus Office. So most of the Office application, I mean all of the Office applications support inking as well, like for pen, right? So it supports writing, it supports your handwriting recognitions. So you can just do your handwriting and then it will be able to convert it into Word for you as well. So those are something good if you have like education, if you're selling to teachers or students, right, for education. Imagine a scenario where they can just hold a tablet and they can start writing on the tablets. We also have smart board applications which you can download for free and run it on a Windows 10 device. So you can even run a smart board solution on a tablet and just project it on the screen. Okay, so those are the scenarios that you can just paint it to your customers. Okay. PC gaming, as I mentioned earlier, the Windows 10 engine itself, right, ever since we launched Creator Updates, there's a new function where you can actually reserve resources just for gaming experience, for a better gaming experience. Alright, so this might not be a big deal for some of us who don't really play games, although I tried just now, right, just right outside. But for gamers, it makes a big deal for them, okay? So even for some of you, you might be selling gaming devices, so this is something that you should look at it. On the other side, if your customers has an Xbox One at home, so Xbox apps runs on Windows 10, right? So you can actually run Windows 10's Xbox apps and get it connected to your Xbox One device, right? So the game that you have on Xbox One, you can actually play it on your Windows 10 PC as well. Okay, so that's another type of gaming experience. So it doesn't matter where you locate your Xbox One's gaming console, as long as it's connected to your internal network, right, together with your PC, once you launch your Xbox apps, you'll be able to run Xbox game on your PC as well. Okay, and the other thing is that today Windows has a new gaming function with Windows Key plus G Key. So this is something that you can actually broadcast while you're playing right now directly to the community. So this is something new that we have embedded into Windows 10 itself. And we have more games coming out in the market. So other than those that you can purchase in the market, which runs on Windows 10, right, you can also download some of those from our Windows Store as well. Okay. So Windows Hello, I've mentioned a little bit about this. So this is mainly to target consumers and also corporate. All right. So for consumers, you can log on using facial, right, face recognition, if you have an Intel 3D RealSense camera, right? Some of them you can actually purchase it separately, it can be an accessory as well, right? Or you have a fingerprint or thumbprint reader. So all these will actually connect to Windows service and will run automatically, okay? For the commercial side, just in case you have customers, you know, asking about it, today we actually have seen some of the customers or even IHV partners who came up with some of the solutions where the Windows Hello itself can work with some other IoT devices. For example, they know that this person is actually approaching this device, right? Because the phone itself has been enabled, has been identified as this person. So once they have sensed that this person is actually right in front of the PC, then they will kick the 3D camera, right? They kickstart the 3D camera and make sure that they have a facial recognition. So it's like a two layers of security to ensure that this is the right person to log on to the device, okay? Alright, so the next thing is that I know that virtual reality is something that's already very common, right? It's happening right now. So there's a lot of apps, games that's already enabled with virtual reality. But if you ask me what is the future, I would say mixed reality is the future. Okay? So if you have experienced like a Microsoft HoloLens or even recently Acer launched their mixed reality lens as well. So those are things that you can actually have the actual reality scenario being built into your some of the apps and solutions. So some of the key examples that I've seen recently, right, in the market is that, so some of them they can even do R&D, they can control using this mixed reality HoloLens device. Okay, so it's pretty cool that the last experience I had with this is, so today in our house we have TV, for example, right, this is for consumer, it's pretty amazing. So I can actually, using this mixed reality HoloLens, and I can just a TV right in front of me, and that thing actually stays there, and I can actually have it to follow me wherever I go in the room. So you can have your TV 24/7 just running on your mixed reality HoloLens itself, or you can just stick it on the wall, right, in the reality, and that thing will actually stick on the wall, and when you walk back to the same spot, then you can see the TV is still there. So this is like how you mix the virtual reality with the actual reality all together. Okay, so even some of the company like Boeing, they already started training using mixed reality. Okay, instead of like getting all the trainees to assemble, disassemble the engine itself, which cost them hundreds of thousands of dollars, now they actually use mixed reality to do all these things. Okay, Paint 3D, this is a first-party app that comes together with Windows 10, right? Something pretty cool for you to kickstart to do some 3D drawing. So in some other markets, the 3D printer is actually quite common right now, and they even foresee that in the future, this is something that will turn into mainstream, where a lot of people, even like a like a young starter, right, Kickstarter, they will be able to produce their product at home using a 3D printers. Okay, so this is something that we're looking forward to for our local market. Okay, I know you guys know about Office 365. I know you've been selling 365. To me, it's like, I know you know and your consumers know about all these features, right? But several things that I would like to bring it up is, so for myself, it worked for me. So if I have an Office 365, right, if I purchase it and subscribe it for my new PCs, I actually get 1 terabyte for free through OneDrive. Okay, so it might not be a big deal, but to me, it's super good because I don't have to back up my data into a separate hard drive. Okay, so all these things, I can actually have OneDrive to sync with my local drive. So whatever I store in that particular folder, it will actually go out to OneDrive. So even some of the times, if you feel that, you know, my device, I'm running on 256 gigabyte of SSD memory storage. So if it reaches a limit, I can just unclick some of the folders and say, do not sync on local PC, but all these files will still store on OneDrive, right? So your data will still remain on the cloud, okay? So they will free up some space on your device. And on the consumer point of view, so I have a phone, it runs on Android, right? So I can actually sync all my photos directly to OneDrive. So it runs seamlessly, okay? So whenever I take photos, and when I go back home, once it gets connected to my local wireless network, it will start to sync all these photos up to the OneDrive. To me, it's like with a family, for consumers, I think the most precious thing for us is to see our kids going out with all the photos and videos, right? So all these things will be well kept on OneDrive, right? It will be there forever. Okay, but if you keep something on your hard drive, you know, who knows, one day your hard drive might fail and things like that. I think the safest space today for us is to keep something on the cloud, right? So 1 terabyte is I think to me is good enough. You can store a lot of things on it. Okay, any question before I go into Windows licensing? No? Okay, very quickly, I'm sure you've seen this. I just would like to emphasize on several key points. So first thing is that, so you know from Microsoft point of view, we actually have different licensing model, okay? The first is what we call volume licensing. So this is mainly used by our corporate customers. So those are bulk purchase, such as open license, select license, and enterprise agreement. But on the other hand, for the retail consumer market, we do have a retail pack, which is a FPP version, right? And of course, we also have a COEM version, and we have a direct OEM versions. Okay, so I think most of the licenses that you acquired in the past or you resell it to your customers are through the FPP or the COEM. So the reason why I bring up this slide is I wanted to mention about a mislicensing scenario, and it's very, very common and it's ongoing. So a lot of corporate customers, I'm sure you have some SMB customers walk into you and say, you know, I already purchased an open license Windows 10, for example. Okay, so I do not require to buy a Windows 10 license when I'm buying a PC from you. So your job or our job is to actually educate this customer and tell them that this is wrong, because the Windows 10 that you acquire through volume licensing is not a base license. It's just an upgrade license. Okay, so which means that when you buy a PC, it must already pre-install and comes together with a COEM or an OEM license before they can apply their volume licensing Windows 10 license on top of it. So normally the version that they have is the enterprise version. Alright? So if they run volume license, like open license enterprise version on your PC, the PC version of Windows must be a Windows 10 Pro before they can actually apply the upgrade license. You cannot acquire a Windows 10 Home, right? Because the version doesn't match. Okay? Pros will go up to Pro to Enterprise. Okay, Home is purely for home use. Okay? So COEM and FPP, I'm sure you know about this. I just like to emphasize on several key points. So FPP, okay, start with COEM. So for all the PCs that comes, like for example your Dell PC or Lenovo PC or some of your DIY PC, you should actually pre-install it with a COEM version of Windows. Okay, so once you pre-install it, when the customers first got a PC and first boot up, they will have to accept the end user's license agreement. Alright, so we are actually purchasing the rights to use Windows. Okay, it's not just about COA, it's not just about the DVD, but they are actually acquiring the rights to use the PC. On the other hand, for full package product, this thing can go to an old PC, for example. Right, so even if you have customers, they're trying to upgrade from their current Windows 7 PC, right, you would like to run Windows 10, you can actually acquire an MPP version of Windows. Okay?
I just want to top up one scenario. I think it's a very important thing to share. That, for example, like today, if you face any commercial or corporate customer, take note that it might be they buy a wrong license and or they want a wrong license. Okay, but of course, from the Microsoft standpoint or even BSA standpoint, if a software audit comes into audit to the customer, they will end up buying GGWA. GGWA is an open license format, okay, that's sold through usually a open license partner and or any of you guys too. And the cost is actually nearly about 30% more expensive compared to an OEM license.
Yeah.
It is like when you buy a BMW, right? It comes with a BMW steering. Okay. So after that, if you change another one and then you want back the original one, usually it will cost more. So reason why we want to share this is so that if you see any commercial customer, do remind the commercial customer that they can get a PC that comes with the right license. For example, like a commercial PC to come with a Windows 10 Pro and or to downgrade to Windows 7 Pro. But if today they get a wrong licensing format or if they install themselves, if software audit comes into play, you either lose revenue to another seller today that need to sell them GWA and or the customer will end up buying from other people. So the key thing that we want to share this licensing piece is so that you get to advise your customer the right thing at the first place. I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, tomorrow you need to tell customer, hey, you must buy 10 Pro now, you know, but the key thing is remind your customer that, okay, getting it together with a new machine will always be the cheapest and easiest way to get the license.
It's the best time to acquire the license as well.
Yeah.
Right. That will be the lowest cost compared across different version or different licensing model that we're offering to the customers. So COEM is always the lowest in terms of cost. Right. Okay, so a little bit on downgrade rights. So some of you will be asking, you know, if I buy Windows 10 today, can my customers use Windows 10, Windows 8, or even Windows 7? So the answer is yes, if they acquire Windows 10 Pro license. So if they acquire Windows 10 Pro, they can actually downgrade to Windows 8.1 Pro, or they can actually downgrade to Windows 7 Pro. Okay, so Windows Home doesn't come with downgrade rights. Okay, so in other words, if they acquire Windows 10 Home license, right, they can't downgrade to the private version, right, unless they get a Windows 10 Pro license. Okay. So have you seen fake CoA or counterfeit CoA being offered in the market at a super crazy attractive pricing? Some may be selling $60, $70. So educate your customers. So we spoke with many partners, especially in client values, right? Some gamers, when they build DIY device, they spend thousands of dollars, right? But when it comes to OS, they thought they could take the chance. So they acquire $60 or $70 fake CoA from online sellers. So basically, by doing so, you are still getting the counterfeit products, right? And the risk is high because a couple of reasons. As you can see recently, we have done a lot of operations, right, through DSA and MDTCC, right, Domestic Trade and Consumer Affair. And some of the sellers, right, has been caught and has been raided. And not only that, some of the customers' database has been captured as well, in the sense that those who purchase the fake or counterfeit CoA license from these particular sellers, their customer database already been captured by BSA. Okay? So there will be a second wave of action being taken. Right? And I understand that this is an ongoing battle, right, with some of these online sellers. We work with Lazada very closely. We took down everyone, right? Like yesterday and today some still pop up. So this is like I say, it's an ongoing battle. So we work very closely with all these online portal. Right? Hopefully we can actually kill piracy one day.
And one more thing to share is that like for example, this case is actually reported by a lot of end customers. Customers don't know, so they actually went online and they buy it, and then after that they faced issues and stuff, and then they came to Microsoft to complain. So reason why I want to share this is so that get the right source or original source to sell to your customer, because some of these counterfeit are not selling at like last time, you know, the 10 ringgit pasar malam, or the 10 ringgit DVD that you bought in the mall and stuff like that. Now, today they are selling at what, 300, some at 600 ringgit, and these are counterfeit products. And at the end of the day, when the customer, they try to activate it, they face issue, and what do? They'll come to, they'll complain to Microsoft. And when we got all these details, usually what we do is we'll pass on either to the lawyers, or to the BSAs, or to NPTCC to do the investigation. Why? Because this is a loss of revenue, not so much for us, but for a lot more other people, like the resellers, for the end users, where they actually paying for something that is worth even lesser, and is actually counterfeit and pirated version of Windows and Office. So it is a good sharing that today, right? I'm not saying that we will be everywhere, but at the end of the day, the end customer themselves also, they, if they're paying that amount, they want to get the right thing. So hence, the key thing is that we have all the right licenses and things available that you can also offer to your customer today to, you know, not to end up in scenario where you yourself also don't. Let me share with you one story. I have this reseller that told me, he said, Kennedy, I have this customer that came and complained, and it's a public listed customer. And he said, I bought this license from an online platform, okay, starts with L, okay, not Lazada, but, you know, and then resell to this customer. And this public listed customer faced activation issue. Half of it is quite a lot. That's about 112 copies, I remember. Okay, and now he got sued by this public listed customer, and he's just a small little dealer. And he said, how can you help me? I said, what I can do for you is, all we can do is you send us all the details, we will get our lawyers to investigate. That's what we can help. But at the end of the day, what he need to do, he need to rebuy 112 license, the right license, and compensate to the customer again, in order so that the customer will not sue him, as if he's selling a counterfeit product. So with this story, right, I actually say that it's not so much of a reseller fault and or end customer fault, but it's just that we need to take note that there's these things available in the market, and we want to avoid to be part of the whole scenario. Because then at the end of the day, from Microsoft's standpoint, is that we want Windows and Office as a service to the customer. And at the end of the day, if they face all these issues, the issue will, you know, be part of the whole entire chain. And us as a seller, sometimes, you know, together as a seller, right, we just want to drive the business and have a long-term relationship and stuff like that.
Yeah. So we always agree to use education, right, as a way to communicate to our customers, and we need your help, right, to share some of the stories and educate them, right, do not take risks. Okay, so it's like what we mentioned earlier, Windows as a service. So if you purchase or accidentally purchase a counterfeit product, right, once Microsoft discovered the set of keys, then you might get blocked immediately. Right? So you will stop getting services update, right? Windows update or creators update, so on and so forth. Okay, so get it right, get it from the right source, right? Get it right the first time that you purchase a PC. So those is the message that we would like to send it to our consumers. Okay? So that's all I have. Any other questions? If not, then we'll leave all the questions to the Q&A sessions. Right, before we go for dinner. I know you guys are hungry. I'm hungry as well. Thank you guys. Thank you.